Mission given to me by Woody Shaw, Sunship, Dizzy, and John Kahn. Dedicated to pursuing a piece of our cultural heritage through interviews with my music heroes, this is the Jake Feinberg Show. Welcome, everybody, inside the Blackwood Broadcasting Studios at an undisclosed institute of higher learning. This is the Jake Feinberg Show. We're happy to have all of you along with us today. My show has been predicated on leadership. Leadership from those who learned with and from the Titans. Nelson Rockefeller? No. Andrew Carnegie? No. I'm talking about Bird and Thelonious Monk and Dizzy Gillespie and Leonard Feather. Playing jam sessions and communicating using nonverbal communication. The idea that melodies and harmonies are words as well. My guest today has been actively playing melodic invention for over 8 decades. It started with Buddy Rich, and has continued with Bill Goodwin. It started in a chateau in France with a European rhythm machine, and has continued with engagements at the venerable Delaware Water Gap watering hole, the Deerhead Inn. My guest today plays and writes across the swing spectrum, from Sonny Rollins to George Russell, from Oliver Nelson to Manny Album, from Billy Joe to Bill Evans. Isn't that what jazz is? A blending of all musics. The longevity of my guest speaks to his dedication to an apparatus. The alto saxophone that had Richie Cole dancing round midnight and left Grady Tate for a late-night rendezvous. Peppering live audiences with plethoras of notes designed to connect synapses that may be dormant or not functioning at all. You see, that's the unquantifiable value of music. What it does to broaden your view. To get an education from geniuses in music has made me a wiser man today. From one proud street scholar to another, Phil Woods, welcome to the Jake Feinberg Show.
Jake, I don't know what to say. That's a beautiful. What a great opening. Man, how can I follow that? Man, I'm going to have to come up with some licks here. Beautiful. Yeah, Bill Goodwin said you were a good man, and from what I've just heard, you are definitely a good man. You got a good soul for the music.
Oh, that's it. Cause I am not a musician, but I feel it, and I think that...
It comes across.
I wanted to read a quote from someone here. It's going to remain anonymous for a little while, but this is one of your former collaborators, people you've collaborated with. He says, listening to Phil Woods, I'm always struck by the visual aspect of his music, not his musical imagery so much as the absolute logic of his choice of notes. His phrases are so exactly right that it's as though they appear right in front of my eyes. I remember what he plays. He's one of the few musicians who, whether we're performing standards or my own music, doesn't scream at what I'm doing. And I think that what I'm getting at is this complete open mind. Your mind has always been open from the days of Springfield, Mass, from New England. And I wonder how much that was sort of built into you and how much that was, and if so, who fostered that open-mindedness towards music?
Oh, that's a tough one to answer, but I mean, it's growing up in Springfield. You know, I have you heard of the Springfield Rifles?
I've been there, yeah.
You know, Joe Morello and Chuck Andrews and Sal Salvador and Hal Sarah and myself. I mean, Hal Sarah lived up the street from me, and when we discovered jazz, I think I was about 14, 13, maybe 12. I think 12 when I first heard jazz. It just struck a chord. I mean, it was a part of the excitement of the end of the Second World War, and I think the whole world exploded with joy. You know, and jazz was the voice of that joy. So it was, I think, quite logical for us as young musicians to gravitate towards Bird, Diz, and Monk. I mean, that was what was happening. And that message what you outlined in your question was made quite clear when we listened to those cats, you know. And mm-hmm. plus, I think my lessons with Tristano helped me because he supplied the intellectual stuff, and Monk, Bird, and Diz. Well, Diz had some intellectual stuff, but Bird was like a comet across the sky. I mean, it was just a skyrocket going off. It was pure gut. I mean, just pure beauty without any syntax, any words. Words were not necessary. And that was quite clear at the beginning, and I don't think I've wavered from that joy that I get from still performing and being around young musicians, and it's a full-time thing. And the thing is, you never quite arrive. I'm going into my 82nd year, and I'm still working. I mean, working at getting better. You know, I'm doing a lot more writing for the big band. Have you got the new big band album, by the way? Did that come your way yet?
You know, I'm looking forward to it, though.
Yeah, that was the last project. So yeah, I hope that's sort of an answer.
No, I mean it's what you're talking about again. Even like micro regionalism, in the sense that, like, when I interviewed Don Menza, and he talked about upstate New York basically being one straight line from Boston to Chicago. I mean, there were so many cats in these local areas, and you reeled off some names that you grew up with.
Well, I mean, when you mention upstate New York, I mean, don't take this the wrong way, but I always call that Wop Bop. I mean, that Italian American thing from upstate New York was great. Springfield, we had a little different thing, but it was, there is a regionalism involved, I think. And Springfield was a good town, and most of our spirits gravitated to New York, not so much to Boston. Although I heard Charlie Mariano on one of the first records I bought was What's New with Nat Pierce arrangement of the Ray Borden Big Band. But nevertheless, our eyes were more southwest.
Yeah, you know something though, you did. You wound up doing some prolific work with. Veritable, I mean, they weren't all from Boston, but they were there at the Berklee School. It was Jackie Byard.
Oh, sure.
And Richard, and actually not Richard, but Alan Dawson was a teacher.
Well, it's a small tribe. I mean, you know. I mean, it is a tribe.
It is a tribe.
You know, and the oral tradition of the tribe goes on. I mean, I God bless all of the jazz schools, but the oral tradition is still our strongest suit, you know. I always tell my students, you know, there's nothing like going... And when I mean it's nothing like going and listening to a live performance, you know. And when we were studying with Tristano, the first time I heard Bird was at the Three Deuces, you know, and had a piece of cherry pie with him. You know, I mean, there's nothing quite like that. I mean, when I heard Coco, the first record I heard of Bird was Coco, and I brought it. I was playing with a band called Carmen Rivoza and his Rhythm Ears, and my father referred to them, Carmen Rivoza and his Riveters, because we were so bloody awful. But you know, and we would rehearse at Carmen's house, and all of the Italian aunts and uncles would sit on the couch and listen to us. Well, I brought the Coco to the rehearsal one time, and I said, listen, wait till you hear this, guys. This is the greatest music ever. And they said, oh, you like that? That's terrible. That's awful. Take that off. And I ended up crying, screaming, you're wrong, you're wrong. And I left in a huff and quit the band. It was my first political statement in favor of Bird and the revolution that was occurring. It was clear to me, but not to the other guys.
Yeah, you know, I'm putting together a show right now for the local affiliate here in Tucson, NPR, about leadership. And because I think there's a huge, and there has been for some time, you know this better than anybody, you took off, you saw the tea leaves much earlier. But being born in 78, I can't really look up to, politicians or athletes or any real public figures. I have to look to people who learned from the original masters, whether it's Bill Monroe, John Lee Hooker, Reverend Gary Davis, Charlie Parker. Yep. And so if you just humor me and my generation a little bit about that gut, that visceral gut bucket approach that Bird brought to the table, and what sort of made you just take notice right away, those unique qualities that were so prevalent at that time.
What made me?
Yeah.
I was hooked. I mean, my ears made me. My ears and my heart made me. I mean, and also when I was a young man, I got drunk with Kerouac and heard and saw John Cage lecture, and I attended Juilliard. So I come from Bird and Diz, but I also come from Bartok. Because I read in Downbeat that Bird loved Bartok and loved Stravinsky. So at a young age, I was a culture vulture. When I saw the Red Shoes, the movie, I took my pastels and made a pastel of a ballet dancer's leg with red shoes. I mean, I was a culture vulture to the. I mean, I even started smoking a pipe, and I had a suit when I was 14, 15 years old. And my mother made a great comment once. I came home with my bad self, and my pipe and all that. And my mother looked at me and she said, "Philip, have you met anybody today that you like better than yourself?" Shot me down quick.
Humbled you, yeah.
And I never forgot that. I mean, what a great line. I mean, that my parents were most supportive, but they were also saying, "It's easy, boy, easy." So I had the best of both worlds from the kids I grew up with playing the music and from the education I got at Juilliard and Manhattan School of Music and studying with Tristano. And then, at 24 years old, Quincy discovered me, and I'm playing with Dizzy Gillespie. I'm in the middle of Abadan, Iran, and I'm playing Groovin' High. I mean, it doesn't get any better than that. You know what I mean?
I agree. I mean, that's almost out of a fairy tale.
It's a fairy tale existence, When I tell the stories, one jazz journalist once said, Woods always is telling the same stories about eating cherry pie with Charlie Parker. And I feel like saying, if you had a drink with Shakespeare, wouldn't you want to tell your friends about it? It's not me that's important, but the fact that these guys were my friends, and my compatriots, my teachers, my mentors, they're part of... All of those cats are part of them belong to me, because I worked with them, I played with them, I got high with them.
Hey, man, no, I mean, this is we're talking to Phil Woods, and let's talk about the on the bandstand. What were the characteristics that Monk? That you might have learned from Monk as being a good leader, especially in the sense of...
Monk was not a good leader.
He was not? Okay, go ahead.
No, Monk was not a good leader. I mean, the first rehearsal for the Hall Overton charts and all that, we played a little Rudy Tooty, And then, it would start with an introduction, and then we'd play... Then Rouse would solo, then Thad would solo, then we'd hit the infamous letter F. And it was a train wreck. And Monk stopped the band. He said, "Back to the top." Now, I didn't mean back to the top, back to letter F, where the train wreck occurred. He meant back to the top, introduction. Thad, Rouse, and we get train wreck. Oh, no, you start again at the top. And finally, Hall Overton... It says, "Excuse me, Monk, I know this is your music, and even though I arranged it, but I'd just like to suggest and point this out to you that, you don't have to go back to the top. You could conceivably, now this is just a suggestion, you could start at letter F," and thank God that he said that. And so, gradually... Monk was a great leader because you knew you were cool when he started dancing around the band, but there was no verbal communication whatsoever. It was strictly very Afro-American in the purest African sense.
In the purest sense, I know.
It was by rote. You had to really learn the music, I had the best of both worlds. I learned at the feet of the. Of the Afro experience, because I used to hang out at the Black Club in Springfield, but I also studied with Hal Overton because he was at Juilliard when I was there, and people ask me about how was it like to play Monk's music. I say, I don't play anything unless I can analyze it at the keyboard, at the piano. I don't play a song unless I know the changes. I try to learn the lyrics, and if not the lyrics, I try to learn the intent of the lyricist. But I mean, Hall gave me copies of all the transcribed monk material that he'd already orchestrated. So I had copies of what we were playing, and I took those home and I went to school on it, you know. And that was one of the most exciting experiences of my life. But I mean, I couldn't say that Monk was a great leader, but just a genius of music, you know. And he said, you know, you got to learn the music. And he liked me. He liked the way I played. I could never figure that out, how I got the gig. But
no, but here you said something really
fat. That's a great leader, but I mean, he, not when it comes to the musical part. I mean, we could have been there. We could have been there to that day in the flower section of New York City and that famous loft, you know. We could have been still playing letter F.
Leadership in the traditional sense. It's the idea of when I interviewed Dave Holland, he talked about when Coltrane joined Miles's band early on. Train would go up to Miles and say, "What do you want me to do? What do you want me to do?" And Miles just kept turning his back on him. And it took him about 2 months to realize that what Miles really wanted him to do was just be himself and play what he felt, play what was in his soul. And he did that in a nonverbal way. And
I mean, that's what all the greats did. I mean, my first night with Buddy Rich, I said, "What do you want from me?" He said, "Wear a clean shirt and swing your ass up." You know, I mean, and people don't realize what a great leader Buddy Rich was, but that was all he said. Swing your ass off and wear a clean shirt. And I can't think of a better philosophy for a jazz musician.
I love that. But you have to understand, this is intergenerational, Phil, and I mean, I'm looking at my generation. I see my friends. They're trying to work through issues in their bands, and it's really, they're hung up on perfection, and they're hung up on micromanagement. And that was, you know that. So that's not what. I want to go back to something very interesting. You said the African-American learning perspective. Can you help me? Can you talk about that vis-a-vis the Western?
Well, it would be presumptuous of me to think that I know anything about Africa, you know, but I know that Oliver Nelson told me he didn't realize it was so hot over there. And he had I was raised by black musicians. I mean, my first tour was with the Birdland All-Stars, you know, and I sat behind Bud Powell and Lester Young, who didn't say a word to each other for 7 weeks, you know.
Wow.
Prez rolled joints and Bud just stared out the window, you know. I mean, there's a whole thing in Basie's band. I mean, there I'm on a bus with all these cats, you know. I mean, I didn't know where to sit. Don't you dare sit in the wrong seat, you know. I mean, Freddie Green will pull a leg out of your ass, you know. I mean, the black bands, they knew. I mean, they'd look at their itinerary and they could tell you where they were going to be staying, where they were going to be eating, who they're going to be making love to, who they're going to be, you know, hanging with, all over the world, not just in America. I mean,
but what is it?
Those are my heroes, and that's where the. I mean, I went to Juilliard, but I got my graduate work on the bus, you know, with Charlie Barnett and Neil Hefti and Quincy Jones and Dizzy Gillespie, and oh my God, you know, the list is long.
How did you meet? Did you meet Quincy at one of these festivals? How did you meet him originally?
No, I mean, he heard me when on the Birdland All-Star tour. We were the band was Al Cohen and Connie Condoli, Kenny Durham, and myself. Arrangements by Manny Album mostly, and we played with Sarah Vaughan's rhythm section, Roy Haynes, John Malachi, and Joe Benjamin, I believe, but mm-hmm. I could be wrong about the bass. And he liked what he heard, and he was putting together a band for Dizzy's 1956. It was the Birdland All-Stars at 56, and Quincy was putting together a band for the State Department, the Dizzy Gillespie tour, which were going to occur in 57. But Dizzy was still working with the Norman Granz in Europe, so Quincy put the band together. And, of course, I mean, because of the nature of the political thing, they had to have some white guys, you know what I mean? I'm not sure that Dizzy would have hired an all-white, I mean, he might have hired an all-black band, which would have been quite normal in America, but because of... of the whole political nonsense, you know. They had to have some salt and pepper, man. So that's how I got the gig, you know. I could play and all that, but I mean, it was Frank Rehak, me and Marty Flash. We're the only three white guys on the band, so there is that. But we could play. I mean, you know, some of the black cats. When they say, well, let's go hear the Celtics. And they always refer to the Phil Woods Quintet as the Celtics.
Unbelievable.
White guys who can play.
Tommy Heinsohn.
White guys who can play. You know what I'm saying?
I know exactly. Right, right.
So that's part of our heritage. And, you know, that's like the highest accolade I could think of, you know, when people like... Kenny Barron or whatever, you know, refer to my band as the Celtics.
Hey, listen, it's so interesting. What a fascinating story. Okay, going back to Monk and Bird for a second.
Yeah.
Even Dizzy hated the word jazz. He called it bebop. And I'm like, if from your earliest memory with Salvador and those cats in Springfield, what were you guys calling the music? Were you calling it jazz? And it didn't.
No, we're calling it bebop, man. I mean, I had the bebop hat and I had a one-button roll and a Billy Eckstein collar and a bebop tie and a beret. And, it was bebop, man. We were boppers, and we still are. But Dizzy hated the word bebop, you know, but it came about through his scat singing. He's singing a lick to a band member who couldn't quite get it in his head how it went. So, you know, he's about a little bebop. But Dizzy thought that, you know, I think we all agree that we'd rather it was called something more fancy.
Right.
But bebop says it, man, and that's what we're stuck with, and we're boppers, and I'm going to be a bopper till I die, but I don't think I'm going to call it free music or loft jazz or Euro bop or, you know, any of the... I mean, we got too many names for stuff, and bebop is good enough for me, man.
Oh, I like
and
it.
And I've always been a bopper. But I'm a musician, so Dizzy and Bird were not just boppers; they were masters of their craft, and spent a lot of time. Bird listened to everything. So did Dizzy. I mean, Dizzy was. Into all sorts of stuff, you know. I mean, the first fusion music was played by Dizzy Gillespie, you know.
Absolutely.
When
no,
they hired Jan Opozo, that was the first. And that led to the whole thing when we got these Venezuelans and Cubans, and my God, the music is so rich. I think if there's any future in jazz or bebop or whatever you want to call it, it lies in the acculturation of jazz and Latin, you know, that's the most exciting new stuff happening for me personally.
Well, there's that. It's not even terminology. I used to think terminology was a big factor, but I actually think that when you talk about Phil Woods and Dizzy and the musical vocabulary was so across the entire spectrum that you could play everything.
And, exactly, you had to.
Yeah. Well, but now everything has become the barriers have gone up. So you know you are you know learning out of this. Curriculum or
well,
this.
They never teach how to play for a vaudeville act in Berkeley and a fire dancer. And
that's
I
right.
played, I mean, playing it for striptease, you know. I didn't see a girl from the front till I was 24.
Well, listen, we have a little bit of music to get to today, so I wanted to throw on a clip of music and then we'll come back and talk about it.
Lovely. Thank you.
long-haired and full mustached, booted, mackinawed, and gloved against the raw New York day, Phil Woods looked like a visitor from a 19th century lumber camp as he steps into the chrome-lined elevator in the RCA building at 6th Avenue and 44th Street. That was The Summer Knows off a 1974 album on Muse, Musique du Bois. How does it sound to your ears, my friend?
One chorus too many. but I just got like let out of jail at that point, you know, and so it was not really, figuratively speaking, you know.
What do you mean by that?
Well, I mean, I just returned to the States, and it was my first recording. I mean, with a major label after 5 years in Europe, and I wasn't sure how it was going to go. And I had a lot, you know, it was a lot on my plate at that point to get resettled. I mean, I could play for my supper all over the world, but I wasn't sure I was accepted as a serious jazz musician in America, even at that point, even though I played with Dizzy and all that good stuff, I was still considered a studio man in many circles. So I guess I was, you know, I was giving it my all. I mean, people asked, what it did? It did lead to getting a group because I wasn't really content with how the rhythm section behaved themselves on that date. I mean, Richard Davis and
Alan Dawson, yeah,
yeah, and Alan and the pianist
Jackie, from, yeah,
Jackie. Yeah, well, I mean, I'm 82. Is it?
It's all right. It's all right.
Yeah. Brains are. But I mean, I wanted to get a band that could do more. I was hearing more. I loved the Cats, but I just wanted more, you know. And I remember coming after that record date. Even though I think it's a great record because it was an important historically for placement for me, historical placement for me. But I remember going to the last sentence in the guy who one of Doug Ramsey's notes were that I was going out to get a pair. No, I was going out to get a beer. It says Phil said as he left the studio, I'm going to go get a pair. No, I'm going to go get a six pack.
you knew that it was a nice startup back in the States, but it was not. It wasn't guys you really wanted to work with.
No, I'd like to work with them, but I was just hearing more. I was hearing a different thing. Mm-hmm. I just had the 5 years of the European rhythm machine, you know, and we were a very tight group. We were taking music off in all directions, and the quality of musicianship was very. I could pass out a part and they'd sight read it. I was not getting that instant communication when I passed out the lead sheet on that date. You know, I mean, some of the changes were. I mean, it felt awkward to me. You know.
Mm-hmm.
So the first person I saw was Bill Goodwin. I said, I got to get a band. Also, I mean, to preface, it wasn't just that, but upon my return to America, I was doing more singles, you know, playing with local rhythm sections to pick up some bucks.
Sure.
But I didn't have a band. It was always catch as catch can. So I said to Goodwin, I got to get a band, you know. And
Did you know Goodwin back when he was with... Jefferson Airplane. When did you first meet Bill?
I first met him when he was with Gary Burton.
Right, and then you saw Bill, and you said,
"I said we got to get a band," and we did. And 36 years later, we're still working together.
That's great. I mean, it's beautiful because it is in that Delaware water gap. I sure hope I can get up there at some point. I just feel like it's an enclave.
It's magic up here. It's magic. We got everybody, all kinds of musicians, from David Liebman to the youngest, to my latest student, Alex Lawrence, who's 13 years old and is the best alto player I've heard in years. So it's, we got old guys like Bob Durow and Herbie Green and me.
Oh, my God. I didn't realize Herbie Green was up there.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And Durow, there are pieces to this puzzle. My engineer is very quick to point out it's the David Frischbergs and the Ben.
Well, Frischberg was also a part of the gap. I mean, this part of the world. He used to play at the we all grew up playing at the various resorts, which also always had jazz musicians playing, you know, and there was always, after the gig, I'd all go to the Deerhead Inn and jam. I mean, it's been that way since the 40s.
At the Gap. I love that. Well, listen, we have a portion of the show called Name That Tune, and I want you to settle in and listen and see if you can identify this session coming up, okay?
Name the tune or the session?
Name it. Just settle in. You're going to really get a kick out of this.
Okay.
All right? We'll come back.
I hate tests.
Phil, give it your best guess.
That's me. Me, I'm acid.
that's exactly right. And I'll tell you. So give me a guess. I mean, let's.
And I'm playing on my electric elephant.
That's that. I want to talk to you about the.
That was with the Oberheim ring modulator, and I think it's a European rhythm machine.
You know, you're. This is something special. I've one of the early sages to this show
it's
that I've
Riot
been
Riot by Herbie Hancock. I know that.
That's right. Very good. That's right. It's Riot, and One of the earliest compadres was the skipper, Henry Franklin.
Oh, Henry Franklin. Oh, okay.
And I spent a week.
That's Pete Robinson.
That's right. I went to Skipper's house for a week in the summer to hang with him, and he had two copies of this record. You can't find the Phil Woods Quartet on acid. I'm kidding. New music by the new Phil Woods Quartet.
Pete Robinson,
Henry Franklin, and Brian Madman Moffat. And
Moffat. Yep. I remember it well. I remember we played in the club in Dante's, and there was Leonard Feather, and I felt like saying, Leonard, there'll be no scrapple from the apple tonight.
No, but I love that, man. I mean, this is, and it's so interesting. Your notes are succinct in the sense that you said it was people did not know what to make of the music, and I that makes me upset because I would have been right up front just having a ball. I mean, to me, this was the first album you made when you came back on test.
That was actually the first thing I made. Yeah, it was. I mean, that's when I went to California. That's the first. That was the first stop. Yeah, and the one you played before the Summer Knows. That was later. That was when I was getting ready to. I didn't know where I was at. Yeah.
The best you can. Can you talk about? I mean, you did say Leonard actually put that band together. So you just kind of reached out to him and said, "I need a band," and he's like, "Here's the skipper, and you're gonna like these guys, Pete Robinson. You're gonna like these guys."
That was before I got a band. I mean, that's when I went to L.A. and I always wanted to have a house with a pool. Big mistake. You know, I spent my day checking for pH content. And I only made $3,000 in that month, and that band never worked. We couldn't get arrested. We gave that record away. We were supposed to go with Richard. I think it was Geffen who took over the. We were a cover band for Weather Report. We thought Pete Robinson. We thought maybe that's where they were going. We wanted to do the whole electronic thing, you know. And we were almost get a contract with it's a major label, but Geffen took over, and he just axed us immediately. Said it was no good, the music we were doing. So that's when we gave it to I forget the name of the label, but we gave it away. We didn't make anything.
It was on Testament Records. You say
Testament. That was it. Yeah.
You say that. I have a question. You said something interesting. You know, you came back to the States still really with an incentive or an impetus to prove yourself. Were you always hearing things like, oh, you're just a Charlie Parker guy? You sound...
Yeah, of course. Especially after I married Chan. And, our Pepper in his book says, you know, Phil Woods loved Charlie Parker so much he married his widow, you know.
Pepper.
And I called him. I said, what the hell is that, Art? You know, and I mean, he said, oh, I shouldn't have said it, but I was on drugs. I said, no shit.
Why do you know, and you even say it here, you know, you say, we didn't exactly bomb. Business was, in fact, very good. And you produce strong reactions. And it's just, to me, I focus in on this time period here where there's this all this new advent going from acoustic to, because the European Rhythm Machine was acoustic band, primarily. I mean, you had an upright bass, drums, and piano.
Yeah, but I had electric sax at one point, too, live at Montreux. I'm using the ring modulator, and I had a baritone sax. It was the first amplification on. So we were headed that way, the Rhythm Machine.
How do you see at the Gap amplification now? I mean, Perla wrote a little thing on Facebook about how you're still just torching people with beautiful, beautiful peppering sounds. But do you guys try to keep the silence within the music? Do you try to keep that balance? Because there is this sort of, you know, at the time it was so new, there was still space in the music. When you have guys like Pete Robinson and Henry, you know, you can pull that stuff off. But how do you guys, what's the configuration of the instruments when you play at the Deerhead?
Oh no, we've gone completely acoustic. I mean, it's back, no microphones. It's back to the beginning. It's back to the. I'd equate it to like an actor who makes huge, gigantic, mega bucks movies, But then for reality, he goes to a very small theater and does Shakespeare acoustically, you know?
Exactly.
I still think my strongest suit is playing a song. Just play the goddamn melody. It only takes forever to learn how to do that. I mean, it's the hardest thing. All those notes I played, that's easy. How about one whole note that means something? I'm still looking for that one. So I mean, actually, I've tried everything. I've done everything. I played with Paul Simon and all that rock and roll shit, and the stuff with Testament and the European Rhythm Machine. But I'm still working on the verse to Body and Soul, which nobody else knows how to play.
Yeah, and it's just, it's so important. You are one of the titans. In 64, just reading, you said you were disenchanted with the jazz scene in the United States.
In 68, you mean when I went to Europe?
I thought it was 64 to 67 in that range. But
no, it was 68.
I guess what I'm trying to say is those middle years in the 60s, what was happening within your personal playing? Or what was happening within the?
Well, I was doing a lot of studio work, and but one of the things that kept me going in America was a school called Ramblernia in New Hope, Pennsylvania, where Mike Brecker and Richie Cole and a whole bunch of cats, and Roger Rosenberg. When that went belly up, that's when Chan and I decided to move to, and we were politically very active. And I had Baird, my stepson, he was getting to be draft age, and it was Vietnam, and it was not a very pretty picture in America, and I wasn't doing any jazz work to speak of. I mean, in 68, so going to Europe was, we took our matching luggage, 24 cardboard cartons, and then moved to. I think I had four gigs lined up, you know, and then one of them was the first gig was in London at Ronnie Scott's, and the guy picked us up, and I had my wife and kids. And as I said, the 24 cardboard cartons, and he picked us up in a Mini Cooper. You know, they didn't know I was coming to stay, and they took us to a hotel in Piccadilly called the Heiress Hotel, you know, hot and cold running hookers. So it was a strange way to start my expatriate life.
With your kids, you know?
Well, I mean, after a week, Jean-Louis Ginebra, the editor of Jazz, French magazine Jazz magazine, heard about that I was there, and he came over and he said, "You want to come to Paris?" And I said, "Sure," and formed the European Rhythm Machine. And before I knew it, I was headlining at all the major festivals, you know. So, I mean, after 5 years, it was time to bring it on home, because Europe gave me the faith that I am a jazz musician. And so I'm always very grateful to the – I always tell my students, too, before you go to college, take a year off and go see how other societies operate, which I learned with Quincy in 59 when we went over there with the Free and Easy to show, you know. So, I forget the question.
But No. I find it hard to believe that you didn't have any jazz work. I mean, I think you were politically active and your son was getting draft age, and Europe has always been a fertile ground for melodic invention. So, I mean, that seems
I'd spent the year there with Quincy in 59, so it wasn't like I was going to a place that I'd never been to before. I knew they knew who I was there, so that's why I said, I'm not going to do any more studio work. I'm going to put it all on the line. I'm going to play jazz. I couldn't just do that in America, you know, just say, okay, I'm not going to take any gigs, I mean, because I still have to raise a family. But I knew in Europe I started making money playing jazz, and that was amazing to me.
Well, we're going to, you know, if there's one thing that I'm going to do, I know the Gap is an institution, but we're going to have to fly out to Southern California to reconvene with the skipper, Henry Franklin. I think that would be fantastic.
I think I'll be out there next April.
Really?
Yeah, okay. For Ken Poston.
What's going on there?
You know Ken Poston, who does the annual jazz festival in L.A.?
I don't know that name. No, go ahead, continue.
Ken Poston, he's been doing it for years. They're doing a salute to Quincy Jones.
All right, well, let's stay in touch about that, because I would love to see you guys. I would be a kid in a candy store if I could see that quartet up there. But, you know, Phil has made allusions to his prolific studio work, and something that my friends and I have really, really settled in on for quite some time and helped us through many, many days. Here's another piece of music, Phil, and we'll come back. I think you'll know this one.
Katie tried, I was halfway crucified. I was on the other side of no tomorrow. You walked in and my life began again. Just when I'd spent the last piaster I could borrow. All night long, we would sing that stupid song. And every word we sang I knew was true. Are you with me, Dr. Wu? Are you really just a shadow?
How about that rock and roll shit?
Yeah, that was. I love that record. Dr. Wu, I am Dr. Wu. You know, they wrote that song for me. That was who they had in mind, so that was quite logical. And
Wait. Please, let's get that on the record, please. Were you you were Dr. Wu?
I am Dr. Wu, according to the guys in the band.
How did they explain that to you?
I don't know. I don't know who Dr. Wu was, but I accept the fact that they were referring to me as that's who the reference was supposed to be. That's what the composer told me.
Fagan and Becker.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
I am Dr. Wu. Yeah. No, I'm very proud of that record, and I'm also proud of the fact that they put me up at one of the biggest. The biggest hotel in Hollywood, and I invited every alto player in California, and I had the largest room service bill ever anybody that played an overdub with a rock and roll group. I broke the record.
Did you guys like Chuck Rainey and Wilton Felder? I've interviewed them. They talk about sort of the quirkiness of those of Becker and Fagan. Did you? Mainly being like, you know, it was cool that you get put up in a 5-star hotel, but kind of like just come in, do your part, and go. Did you have any interaction with them, or were they?
No, not at all. It was just me and Becker actually in the studio at that point.
Wow.
And I was in and out of there in a half an hour. And I'd been partying my ass off in this hotel and running up the bill, and it was around Thanksgiving time, and I was going to get the red eye back home. And I said to myself, man, this is like stealing without the risk, you know?
I love it.
And I get to LAX, I get on the plane, I'm up there in first class, and all of a sudden the pilot says, ladies and gentlemen, we're having a slight problem. We're gonna be here until daylight because of fog. And I sat on this in the first class plane, and the captain says, "And we're going to open up the bar to everybody." And by this time, I had drank my share of everything known to man, and I'm sitting next to this 300-pound black lady, who proceeded to get totally stoned, And I'm sitting there, and I'm trying to sleep, trying to get myself together because I got a connection in Chicago, which I missed. I missed Thanksgiving. And you know, the easy gig, huh? Easy gig. I was, you know, in the studio a half an hour, but I was, you know, getting there and getting back and missing my Thanksgiving dinner. It was, you know, it was rather ironic.
Well, for a lot of younger cats, it is kind of cool. People will say, "Hey, you know who does that sax solo on Dr. Wu? That's Phil Woods." And now I can say, "Yeah, and actually, Dr. Wu is Phil Woods."
Yeah, that's right. That's right. I still get comments that people yell out from an audience, "Dr. Wu."
Hey, you know, Phil, we have a lot more to get to, but my studio time is
I understand
coming to a close. But I wanted to just before we leave. Talk a little bit about, like you said, you know, you're still learning and you're still growing. And, you know, what are some of the most important things that you want to, aside from putting out, you know, new albums and making good music, what are some of the things that you want to continue to build on insofar as making sure that the music carries on, is sustained, because you actually play the music.
Well, I mean, I'm not as fleet of finger or foot as I once was, you know, with my emphysema and all that. So I want to do more writing, and because the traveling is just too much. So I'm not doing too many gigs. I mean, I'm playing at the Blue Note next week with the quintet. The quintet still goes.
I saw that.
And then we're going to fly. I got to fly to Chile, but the international flights are okay because they take good care of me. But flying in those little Embraers and just going to like Cleveland or something. I can't do that anymore.
You know? Yeah, right.
So, I want to be 82 coming up. So I just want to stay home and write music and work at the Deerhead Inn and get my school going. Coda Camp is, you know, our festival is called Celebration of the Arts, CODA for short, and we just, 5 years ago, we started a school, because in my heart, I'm Ram Blerney, the school I had in New Hope, the one with Mike Brecker and Richie Cole and all those cats. As I say, when that went belly up, I moved to Europe, so I wanted to start a school again, and 5 years, we have a school going here, and we have a big band just recorded, and life is good, so yeah. I really have no... I've done just about everything I wanted to do, but I do want to write a major piece for the alto saxophone and orchestra. That's my next big project.
Well, in the next time we chat, I'd like to talk to you about this thesis that you were writing on the impact of Charlie Parker and the garment industry, on the garment industry. That was done back in 73. On this Phil Woods quartet album, after you guys dispersed and you went back to the East Coast, you say, "I soon left the fertile valley of creativity and moved back east, where I currently am engaged in writing a thesis on the impact of Charlie Parker on the garment industry. The film rights have been sold, and Wayne Newton has agreed to essay the starring role."
I don't know what that meant, man. I think I was referring to Wynton Marsalis's. The guy that writes, the critic that works for him, I forget his name, and he once put my band down because we didn't dress right for the, you know.
Who was it, like Phil Schaap or someone?
I was wearing a cowboy hat. Well, I used to be like a hippie kind of, you know, we didn't get dressed up. So I think I was making reference to the fact that we're going to get dressed up and all that and the clothing industry or something. I don't know, man.
No, still keeping it fresh and still growing. And Phil... thanks so much, and good luck at the Blue Note, and we'll be in touch for another part, okay, man?
I enjoyed chatting with you, and I'll see you down the line. Maybe see you in L.A. Look up that gig. It's going to be a testimonial to Quincy Jones, and I'm going to play the music from This Is How I Feel About Quincy. You know that album?
Absolutely.
Yeah, so that's the whole idea. So maybe I'll see you there.
All right, my man. Good to talk to you.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
This is the Jake Feinberg Show, and we'll see you all in a little bit.